So moved.
Second.
A roll call, please.
Mrs. Elton?
Yes.
Mr. Peck?
Yes.
Mrs. Ross, yes. Mrs. Serbia?
Yes.
Mr. Uglar?
Yes.
Dr. Spencer?
Yes.
Mrs. Dubay?
Yes.
Yes.
Seven yes?
Yes, sorry.
Superintendent, please.
One of the things the board just approved that they heard a little bit about at the meeting last week was we don't always have a gift to bring in front of the board. And we did this month a very generous gift from the Ralph Wilson Foundation, which is based in Detroit and has a mission of delivering a very large estate over the next several years of Mr. Ralph Wilson to a variety of different projects and programs that involve students learning, especially hands-on learning. We were approached by Mr. Jeff Libman, who is the chair of the board that is charged with giving out this estate per the directions of Mr. Wilson, that he heard very positive things about our CTE program in the district and has donated $25,000 to the district in order to, he, in his words, do something different than we're already doing in CTE. And we certainly aren't in final stages, but I did let the board know last week that we are hoping to begin the process of starting an HVAC program at the Panko Center to start another CTE program with this money. It will help us get it off the ground, and it's a need in our area and community, very short of heating and cooling technicians and planners, and have the ability to look at those very complicated systems. So a thank you to the Ralph Wilson Foundation for that wonderful grant that we will put to good use. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now my item I would like to discuss also that was brought in front of you last week. We had some, a little bit of roller coaster activity in one of our properties for sale. This property I'd like to discuss right now is the property on North River Road, and the board asked a couple of things, and one of them most significantly was to work with the prospective buyer on a counter offer, and there was some information given by the board on that. I did say I would bring it back in front of you because it is a very motivated buyer who is interested in making a very quick sale. It is a cash as is sale. So we do have a attached is the offer to purchase, which is legally correct, and it is as is in every way possible. As soon as this property closes, should the board accept this offer, which will be hopefully within 10 days, it will be a cash offer, and we, our liability on the property will cease. And this again is for the old CLL building on North River Road in Mount Clemens. So I would just like to read the background a little bit for those, in the audience for the record. There were two offers received on a vacant building for sale on North River Road. Initially, one was a cash offer of $200,000 as a sold as is condition. The second was quite a bit higher for $475,000, but based on significant contingency in regards to the condition of the building and closing, if we were to accept, or if the board were to accept the first offer, or the second offer, excuse me, the more expensive offer in closing would not be until March 19, 2019, which is about 15 months from now. We did pursue back with that buyer a little bit, and he did not have an interest of accelerating that timeline. We did find out there was an additional contingency of approval, not only locally at the city level of Mount Clemens for zoning change. There's also some state money that had to be applied for, and that was conditional upon the acceptance as well of that second offer. So at this point, I did engage in additional negotiation with actually both of them. And on buyer number one, the cash offer, we have gotten the buyer to make a final offer of $215,000. I'd like to bring that in front of you for consideration this evening. And The recommendation is that the board motion to approve the sale of the vacant building located on North River Road to Rafat Isa in the amount of $215,000 and approve the attached resolution authorizing the superintendent or designee on the authority to execute all documents related to the closing of the sale. For the information of the public, the intent of this is to put extensive renovations into it in the neighborhood of $750,000 in order to turn it into a senior assisted living center.
I have a question.
Yes.
So I do see what's attached here, but in the actual purchase agreement, we can scroll down
Yes.
into the actual attachment and the purchase agreement, the purchase price listed there is $200,000 and not the $215,000.
I apologize for that. It is $200,000, I agree with you, I see that. The resolution for $215,000.
Creuse appeared on the agenda, it was $215,000, and that's what we ended up signing.
Okay.
I apologize, thank you, Rochelle.
Because I do see the letter from Truman.
Yes. You're seeing the original and then the addendum with the agreements, not only to protect on the as-is offer, but on the increased price of $215,000 on the addendum.
I'll second.
Thank you, motion.
Mayor, Mayor.
Okay, sorry, Mary Jo.
So one of the things that I think is really worth the point out is that we did have options of which way we went to look to sell this property. And obviously, the senior assisted living was one of them. And another option that was possibly out on the table was possibly making this low-income housing, which would have increased the number of students ensuring on plumbers, but probably not the best property value for closer to our neighborhood. So what we were trying to do was kind of look out for the community as well as getting the best deal for our taxpayers.
And I think it needs to be stated.
That the property was in much need of repair, costly repairs. Heating system, roof, and that's talking big dollars. And if he's willing to take it on as-is, and he doesn't even got into the building really to find out, he's probably going to not want to go down.
Well, and the cost of maintenance for the building was really.
Yeah, we're stopping the maintenance as soon as this is signed, correct?
Correct.
Roll call vote, please.
Mrs. Hilton?
Yes.
Mr. Peck?
Yes.
Mr. Huber?
Yes.
Dr. Spencer?
Yes.
Mrs. Dubay?
Yes.
Mrs. Ramos?
Yes.
And Mrs. Servino?
Yes.
Seven.
Okay, moving on to curriculum.
I need to move to this side because I guess I can't control this presentation from my seat. Annually, we bring forward a recommendation to the board for school choice. Oh, sorry, for school choice. And we prepare a brief presentation to kind of give some background on that and some general information for that before making a asking for a recommendation for that. So we are going to use this. Come on forward up here. There we go, that is it. Somebody will do this from here. There we go, smash it as you go.
Yep.
There we go. So you just had to walk over here by the end of that. So here's some definitions for school choice. Section 105 permits local school districts to enroll students who reside in other local school districts within the same intermediate school district, meaning that school choice students would come only from the Macomb ISD school district area. Section 105C allows districts to enroll students in from districts outside of the intermediate school district. Currently, we participate in Section 105 school choice, not 105C. This is our decline in student enrollment since 2010. As you can see, we have declined significantly. The annual funding impact for that is really rather large, and when you make a cumulative total of that, it gets even bigger. Keep in mind, this decline of students is just year to year our total decline in student population.
our FTE dollar amounts just for our fall 2017 school of choice students. So in the grade levels K through 8, we enrolled 286 students in the fall for school of choice, and we enrolled 18 students in grades 9 and 10 for a total of 304 students. This is just over $2 million worth of revenue for the school district on schools of choice students alone. This graph, and I apologize because it is hard to read from the audience, but it is important to look at, and it is available online. The yellow shows you all of the districts within Macomb ISD that participate in Section 105 School of Choice. As you can see, they're all highlighted in yellow. If they, to the next column, they will participate in 105C, which takes them outside of the county. And in the final column, it tells you what the level of participation is, as every district has a little bit different participation in terms of whom they accept, K through 8, limited enrollment, and so on. But as you can see, all of the districts in Macomb County participate in 105. This graph requires a little bit of explanation. This is our school of choice enrollment by grade, by school. So they are in alphabetical order, starting with elementary. And Atwood Elementary, starting in 2014, we went back a few years, the total number of school of choice students was 86 out of a total population of 685. And it continues down for each year until you can see for the fall 2017, the total participation for school choice is 19% in Atwood. So each building breaks down to the percentage of students enrolled in school choice by building. And we continue through that with their every single building all the way through secondary, as well as the totals for the district. So we are right around 14% for 2017, as well as we were around 14% for 2016. So there has been a little increase in the last couple of years, but not a substantial amount. Our proposal for school of choice for 2018-19 is an unlimited schools of choice, kindergarten is grade through 8, which is what we are currently participating in. Limited school of choice for grade 9 and 10, that's 20 seats district-wide, and that is a lottery system if we receive more than 20 applications, as well as our specialized program at MST, application as well as open seats. If we had students who met the criteria and there were more students than there were seats, we would also hold a lottery for those seats. Questions?
Yes, I'd make a motion to approve the administration recommendation that the board approve and authorize the administration to execute unlimited seats, number of seats for kindergarten through eighth grade under the Michigan Schools of Choice Program, Section 105 for the 2018-19 school year. Acceptance between the time period of February 1st through September 7th, 2018.
Second. Roll call.
Mr. Hugler?
Yes.
Mrs. Ross?
Yes.
Dr. Spitzer?
Before you roll call, is there any discussion?
I have a quick question. Approximately how many students of our almost 12,000 are school districts?
Do you have a number?
14,000.
No, approximately how many number? What's the number of our school districts today?
It's 14% of our total.
Yeah, what's that number?
Well, according to this slide, it's 1,459. They have a fall population of 2017, 10,113.
It's 14%. So 14% of our students is about 10% of our budget, right? Is it less than 10% of our budget? Because 14% of that group of students that you just gave me is not quite $11 million, and we have a $105 million budget, right? Is there
about that, yes.
So 14% of our students is about 10% of our budget, right? How are we making up that other 4% of the budget?
Well,
asking, how are we making up the other 4% of the budget?
I'm sorry, I don't understand.
14% of our students, 14% of our students are school choice students. If you take the foundation allowance for each one of those students, that 14% of the students, that's about roughly $10.5 to $11 million. That is about 10% of our budget. If 14% of our students is 10% of our budget, how are we making up the difference?
The 4%.
Yes. How are we making that up? Is it all taxpayer money?
So what she's saying is that we spend 14% of our budget on these students, but we're only making 10% of our budget back from having these students.
Exactly. If 14% of our students are bringing in the revenue for 10% of our budget, how are we making up the other 4%? Is it all taxpayer money?
Not all taxpayer money, because there are grants that are shelter-related.
And how much are those?
Per student?
Are they 4% of the budget?
Okay, can we go back to that?
How is that different than any other student?
I don't mean to sound this foolish, but I'm getting lost in the numbers right here, so if, bear with me, just go back to that again, Mary.
So for other students that live here, their parents pay taxes, and that does make up the revenue that we don't get from the state.
So what I want to know is, you're telling me that grants make up for that other 4%. It seems like an awful lot of money. My question is this even a little bit cost effective? If 10% of our, or 14% of our students only bring in 10% of our budget, and our taxpayers are picking up the rest of it. Our taxpayers are already picking up the overage from our own students, but are we picking up the extra 4% from school choice too? Is it cost effective? Because it doesn't sound like it when you just do the simple math. Because we're asking your taxpayers to pick up the extra.
I'm still kind of lost here, because all we're saying is these 14% of our student population are school of choice students. Those 14% of our student population equate to the same FTE as our in-district students.
Yes, but you also, for your in-district student, also pay a large tax bill, as do I for my in-district students. So, for my in-district students, Lance Creuse gets a foundation allowance, but they also get my tax check, which goes ahead and supplements this. So what I'm saying is if you have 14% of your students only bringing in 10% of your budget, we're missing 4% of our budget for these students.
I hear you.
Is it all being made up by tax money?
I hear you, but I don't.
It's grants. And grants are not 4% of our budget.
No, but I'm not so certain, and I'm feeling sort of foolish thinker trying to figure this out on my cell phone right now, but I'm not so sure that that necessarily equates to a 4% reduction in our monies. I'm hearing what you're saying.
It's not a reduction.
No, okay, so it's a 4% difference.
My tax check is now supplementing school of choice students. That's
well, our tax, but besides the fact that we don't do our property taxes no longer fund schools the way they used to, that's not just a big collective to the state and they send the money back. So it's while we're all paying taxes in the districts we live in, the way it used to be funded isn't the way it's funded anymore. So it's really hard to say my tax dollars paying for that, and they're not, because for every student who's in this district, there's another student that's a different district, maybe from ours or some other one, that are doing the same thing. And since the money isn't technically coming from our property taxes the way it used to, I think that's where I'm getting tripped up here. It doesn't equate in my mind. It doesn't make the same sense.
Here's the thing. We have a certain amount of money that we have to spend on our students. The school of choice population does not bring in enough money to pay for the 14% of the budget that they should be picking up. It's not one-to-one.
No, and I don't think it will be, but I think we should flip that question is, what will happen to those 14% of our student body where they're not here? That's $2.4 million that's gone, and how do we make that up this year? And then how do we make up $4.8 million next year? And how do we make up 12.2 or whatever.
So sometimes you right-size your district based on that.
I'm just saying that there's
sometimes you don't have to be desperate for teaching staff.
This is being oversimplified, confused, and miscommunicated. We all have access to public data, and I'll reference Bulletin 1014 that defines where we get our money from and how. And as I said, there is multiple ways that we receive money besides state aid, federal grants, state grants, etc. So those monies aren't as simple as you're purporting it to be. And if the one thing you could do is look at that chart, which we all have access to again, and you can see where the money comes from. And that's where it's assigned. So it is, you know, the answer to your questions in data that's supplied everybody in the state.
We're not getting an extra 4% from anywhere other than our own community.
I can't argue with that. And the facts are in front of me on Bulletin 1014 on where we receive, and it lists every district in the state on where they receive their monies from. And so I would ask that you review those numbers and you will see where the money comes from.
We're $5 million short with this.
It seems to me what we're talking about here, if the per pupil money that we got for every student exactly paid for their education, that would be one thing, but it's not. And that was what was behind the adequacy study. The adequacy study showed that high school students take by far more to educate than elementary students. So the whole simple, it's cost this much more and, does it pay for their education? It is complicated. It seems to me the bigger question is, if we don't have school of choice and we have $2.4 million that we have to cut, it affects all kids' programs and services, not just those that are coming in. So the question before the board is, and as much as I did not know, what was going to come forward here today, but I think we need a lot more information about school of choice, data, how much we would lose, how much we would gain, and frankly, I think we need to hear from people in the community, or maybe related to a survey or whatever, but we should be a data-driven board. And just in the last few days, I learned about the $2.4 million that if we did not participate, we would lose. But frankly, when I've gone door to door, there's a massive misunderstanding about school of choice. Some people believe that we're taking kids from Detroit. Other people believe that we're getting our kids from Mount Clemens. Other people believe that it's all over the place. And in reality, and we talked about this at our work study session, is that the very first thing we have to do is get everybody on the same page about what 105 and 105C is, and have everybody have a good understanding of what school of choice is, how much money it brings in, what we would lose if we did not participate in one or the other, the timelines. I just asked Eric the other day, because I thought, well, what happens if we were to participate in limited choice for our middle schools? And the bottom line is, it's because the state only allows you to have a 1 month period of time to take students in under that thing. So there's a lot to be said. So I, for one, feel like, and I tried to jot down a few notes, but I think we need to do four things. I think we need to build awareness of what school of choice is and is not, the timelines and requirements for each. And two, I think we need to collect data about achievement, engagement, behavior, and growth for all of our students. And then I think we should have a community survey, because just as Mrs. Hilton talks to people, Mrs. Servio, we all individually talk to a few people. It's only a drop in the bucket in terms of all of the people, the thousands and thousands of people in the community that elected us. So once everybody's on the same page, once everybody has accurate data, and once everybody's on a level playing field, then and only then would I think that the board have enough information to make a decision. I think we also are strong supporters money. And to all of a sudden sit up here with very little data and information and say, you know what, let's cut $2.4 million to right size. And I'm not saying that I'm against right sizing, because this board has heard there's some things that I have concerns about, but to all of a sudden withdraw $2.4 million in the havoc that it would wreak on our current students and on our current families, I can't.
Are you asking to table this for more information?
No.
I have a comment about this. When we talk about these percentages, 14%, that's not 14% new people coming into the district.
No.
Some of these students may have started in kindergarten or are now in high school.
Right.
So the amount of money being lost, or the difference, is the number of students we actually take in this year. It's not this 14%, it's the number of students we actually take in. Would be the, if we didn't take any new students in this year, that's the amount of money we would lose. So this $2 million is not accurate.
That is,
no.
Those are the students we just took in this year.
Yeah. For the we're looking for the coming school year.
Well, I don't know that yet. We haven't had
it. Yes, but we're asked to vote on, are we going to continue this program? We've already had students in the program. They stay forever and ever.
Right.
But for the next enrollment cycle,
correct,
which would be in for the September class, we're saying we're betting it's two, but it's not 2 million.
Well, we're saying is the current number that enrolled for this school year, 17-18, was that 2 million. So if we got the exact same number,
that excludes it, just those enrolled.
Yes, just those new.
Not
enrolled.
The ones that have been here since kindergarten.
No.
Just the new enrollees.
We've also lost quite a few schools of choice students too, because there's an awful lot of the school of choice families that hop from district to district to district. We know that. So there's a big turnover with that too. My contention remains that if 10 or 14% of our students bring in 10% of our budget, then all of those people cutting their 18% checks for their summer homes, for their businesses, for everything else, they are footing this bill. And I don't think it's fair for our community to say that something that we're on the financially losing end of, we should be supporting.
I think what we need to clarify is the 14% is the current, all of them, it's all of them. The number that I gave you, Terry, that you're talking about is just the new enrollees.
Right.
Just new
predicting.
That 2.4 million is just for this year.
Right. So there's no confusion about 14%.
Correct. The 14% is the total number we have right now. I just wanted to clarify
for
you.
Right.
No. All the slots that we have available that we're predicting that we would fill were filled, then we'd have $2.4 million.
I can't necessarily say the number of spots we have because K-8 is unlimited.
We're
just saying if it was the exact same as this year, then we got the exact same number of enrollees.
Okay.
Terry, I appreciate what you said, but I'm just going to make a comment here. We have the same vote every January required by law, and we get a lot of data throughout the year. So I don't know, but I think it's fair to say you just found out about some of this data, because we, in our workshops, we get some stuff, and we had stuff from last year. I think I remember that our numbers were pretty close in terms of who was leaving and who was coming in school of choice. I do not disagree with, I've said for a long time, our community needs to understand what this means. What is 105, 105C, what is contiguous district, what is just within district, all that sort of thing, because the more information, correct information they have, the more they understand, the more they will be able to really make a comment versus just an emotional worry, you know, my neighbor says this, so I have to follow that. We've done a lot of things where we have workshops with some of these data on here for the community. They don't usually show up for it, but they're there. And they're available on the website too. Granted, you have to know it's there to look for it, but if you really care enough about it, you're going to see something around the website or calling for information. So I think, Lisa, hasn't our numbers been kind of close to 2.25?
It's the number that we get in each year?
Just like our in and I'm going to call it in and out flight, a better way to say it. Like those who come to our district, those who leave our district. We've had time where we've got pretty close for a couple of years, and then we've got some where there's a different disparity, but overall, the bottom line is, you guys, school of choice is a very difficult animal right now, but this is the hand we are dealt from our legislature. And at some point, just finishing my fifth year on the board, I've been saying the same thing. At some point, we either engage the legislature and get them to see and understand what it is they're doing and how they're changing districts and destroying districts. We can complain or not complain all we want about this, but the truth is these numbers, we've had lots of numbers like 14, 15, 16, 17, that's 4 years right there. And we've had this data in many forms on different occasions but over the past year, 2 years, whatever. But yeah, certainly our community should have a survey, but only after they have been absolutely educated and they can make an informed decision. But the bottom line is still going to remain. They can all say, no, we don't want it. But we, the board, will be faced with slowly or very quickly destroying the district based on what we decide to do with the hand that we're dealt. If this is so egregious, and we want to get rid of it, we start engaging Lansing and we change it there.
I just want to, and I know, Don, I told Amy that you want, but I just want to respond to Sharon. I have data, and I've seen the data, and when I was a candidate for the board, I saw that data. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that data, particularly, I don't want to hear, oh, I talked to this one and this one.
Right.
That is not representative.
No, I agree.
Have we done a survey of what the community truly believes? Because there are just as many people that I've talked to door to door that said, I came here, I moved here because I love the welcoming and the diversity. I've talked to other people that had the misperception of school of choice, and they are blaming that a lot of behavioral problems on school of choice kids, when in three other districts that I know of, when they did do look at the data, it was not the school of choice kids that were having the behavioral issues.
That was true too.
So what I'm saying is, I'm not talking about one data point. I'm talking about a key missing one. We can't sit up here and say, well, I talk to people, so because of that, I'm voting this, because we don't know what the people really believe.
I agree, and to that point of the behavior, I think it was probably 2 years ago, there was a lot going on about that, and we had a lot of data that said, guess what, kids? Your school of choice kids, they're, in some cases, even better than your own district kids, so.
Well,
Jeff.
For the last 3 years, this board has sent a letter to their state and our legislature, the Department of Education, indicating that school of choice is something that, although it is law and it's implemented, it has a tremendous impact on local school districts. And we've asked, and I think we continue to ask, that our legislature look at the impact of school of choice to our local districts and our students. I would hope that we would encourage, again, our legislators and as a board speak out to Lansing and the impact. Secondly, I think it's a great idea. I think it is important that we communicate with our community, our staff, and continue to survey and see what the impact of our district is. Without a doubt, that's our obligation and our role to do. But the reason I raised the original motion, this is a recommendation from our administration. And they are the people that we look to for leadership. It is our obligation to ask questions, to ask tough questions, but also to support our administrators in giving them the tools and the resources to provide an educational environment to all our students. And you know, I know when we do our student of the month, we don't ask them if they're school of choice students or not. They're our kids. And I think that's what we should continue to reflect on, that we're here to help all students and to provide that. And that is why I made the original motion.
I have one question. Of this 14%, what percentage of that is the students that come from China? Because their class is school of choice, correct?
They pay tuition.
They're not class. They're separate entities.
I'm in favor of the motion, and for me, it's kind of, Don, you said it, but it's level of service. I don't know how we can provide the same level of service if we're talking about loss of revenue, and I get it, and it is, unfortunately, due to demographics, I think, largely, that we have to engage in this program, that we don't have the population of students that we used to. I remember talking to some of the older I'm not going to say older. I'm a more mature mature members of our community when they were doing double sessions at the high school while they were building the other high school. So I get it. This district was born out of people wanting to, you know, be like frogs by the water, you know. So we've grown huge. So I get it. But I think that if we're going to continue to provide a level of service until I think it comes full circle, which if anything, Terry, I would like to see another demographic study, because I know that was a tough study to go through or sit through as someone on the parent advisory, but I think that has to be shown, because we just see constant decline in enrollment, and it's due to our area and I think the more mature group of people that live in this district, which is what it is. So I think that we will eventually get out from school of choice. But for now, I think to provide the same level of service, we need to keep track with school of choice and, you know, see how it goes.
We sat here earlier today and we talked about goals. I guess if the board decides based on data and input and whatever that this is something we want to move to right size, to do whatever, then so be it. But I'm just saying the timeline involved here, and I also think it's important for people in the community to know that after the recession, the state of Michigan, it's not just Lawrence Creuse, the state of Michigan has lost thousands and thousands of families. And so the whole state's declining, and the birth rate in our area, plus the fact that we're a late community, people tend to stay longer and older than they would typically do in another community. So there's a lot of reasons why, and I just think it requires a more thoughtful consideration.
So can I just summarize what I'm hearing so far? Everybody thinks it's a bad idea.
No.
Well, I hear Don saying that it's not good for our community, it's not good for Macomb County, it's not good for the state. We sent letters to the legislature. I hear people saying eventually we'll get away from it, but right now our community just needs to like pay for it.
So no, that is not what was said.
Okay.
I think we send a double message when we send a letter to the legislature, says we don't like this, we don't want this, it's, we don't feel it's good for the entire state or Macomb County specifically, but then we vote for it. So it's sending a double message. Well, if you don't like it so much, why are you voting for it?
Because the writing is on the wall for the district if you don't do it.
The students and teachers are a priority.
So I feel strongly in standing up for what you believe in, and I don't think that across the board we're doing that here. So could I call a question, please?
Sure. Well, I think everybody's kind of spoke on the issue.
Okay, let's roll call. All right, Mr.
Huker. I already voted.
No, you didn't.
Yes,
you
did. Yes, you did. And then I said, okay, first comment.
Mr. Servio.
No.
Dr. Spencer.
Yes.
Mrs. Dubay.
No.
Mrs. Selton.
No.
Mr. Pegg.
Yes.
4-3.
Okay, moving on, business office.
I have no report.
Do you have a second motion to consider?
There are two motions.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Limited seats.
I make the motion to accept the administration recommendation that the board approve and authorize the administration to execute a limited number of seats, 20, for 9th and 10th grade, as well as a limited number of seats, 6 for 10th and 10 for 11th grade, for our school program with criteria-based admission. Under the Michigan School of Choice Program, Section 105 for the 2018-19 school year, acceptance between the time period of May 1st and May 31st, 2018.
Second.
Okay.
Roll call.
Wise discussion. Any discussion? Okay, roll call.
Mr. Huber.
Yes.
Mrs. Ross, yes. Mr. Pegg?
Yes.
Mrs. Elton?
No.
Dr. Spencer?
Yes.
Mrs. Servio?
No.
Mrs. Dubay?
No.
4-3?
Are we all set?
Okay, yes.
Business office? Nothing?
No, don't worry.
That's first. Human resources?
No report.
You lucky son of a gun. No kidding.
Public relations? I don't see Kelly here. Unfinished business? Any unfinished business? New business?
I apologize, I was getting out of the room. Was there some discussion on dates for upcoming workshops?
Oh, yeah, we were supposed to discuss the workshop.
Summer workshop, the spring, summer, and fall workshop dates for?
There was not a discussion.
There was not, okay.
Okay.
Well, I'm just, that was a discussion for us, so I apologize. It doesn't need to be right now, it's whatever.
I thought we were just going to move on to more of a request calendar about updates.
Could we choose the months we want to use? Like, for the spring one, April to May?
Yeah, because I know we had our fall in November.
Spring is April. Summer? July, is it July we do it, or June?
Hold on.
August? And fall?
You're saying August or summer?
Right. Just before school starts back up. And then for the fall, do we want to really do it in November because we're starting to bump into holidays? And it doesn't have to be a Saturday, it can be a weekday workshop.
I think for the fall, we did the first week, like the last week of September, the first week of November.
What the summer in July, and because we usually only have one board meeting in July,
well,
we can replace it with a workshop.
And now we have two.
Well, we could still, it's kind of hard, I know, in the summertime to.
I'm sorry, were we doing something new? I know usually an email gets sent out.
Why don't we send an email out? This is basically but we will send this out soon.
I think it's easier, yeah.
Make some proposals for each of those dates,
and
just so we can get this out.
Yes.
Okay, as far as new, it's just it just came up when I talked about the voting community, and Eric earlier talked about some additional revenue that was gifted to the district, but I just think that it would be really wise to look at offering a program on marine engine repair, because a lot of people on my street and people that I talk to, they those guys that are doing marine repair are working like 80 hours a week during the high seasons, and there's nobody coming up behind them, kind of concerned. And so that would be a good thing for our students to work in, especially those planning to continue to stay in our community. So if we could really look at the feasibility of offering something in the marine repair area, I think that would be very helpful.
I think that there's like all different kinds of marine repairs, and there's all types of different engines, and it would be probably behoove us to look into the different types of marine. Because they sub-specialize. I didn't realize this until you were considering buying a boat.
The one that I wanted to do some research on would be the Merck, because a lot of boats have that Merck.
Well, there's outboards, inboards,
right.
And then there's another one.
Yeah, it'll need some study.
I think we're in a position right now, we just got a grant, we're going to work on the HVAC program, and I think let's tackle what we have in front of us. And once we have that established and figure out where that's going, certainly we can explore a grant to maybe start a whole different area of CTE, which I'm in huge favor of CTE, but let's kind of not put our cart before our horse. Let's not raise our carts either.
Well,
oh yeah, I know.
So the
The foundation that gave us $25,000 has other money out there that they might be interested in doing this. If we come up with, you know, this is our HVAC program. Oh, by the way, this is another program we're going to do.
And in reality, Eric said that the reason that word kind of got to these people about our CTE program, in particular the HVAC, and so if we make inquiries about small engine or marine repair, that might be something that somebody there would really want to fund. So I'm just saying, just insert it into the networking. And of course, we've got to do a good job with what we said we're going to do.
I think you, and I agree with you, let's run with what we've got right here and get that thing up and running. But for our future, we definitely need to have more engagement through the meetings that Eric was close to, but also through employers are talking to colleges, and we need to be talking to colleges and community colleges and anyone else, even employers in our community, because that issue is going on everywhere. There are no replacement employees coming back for a lot of these skilled jobs, and it would behoove us to be very, very in the forefront of making sure that this won't be an issue, because we can do this. Mm-hmm. We can do this.
Any other new business?
I got nothing.
Correspondence. I have a letter. I shall not read it. It is from a high school student talking about the need for sleep for high school students more than other students. I think we've had discussions before. I think most parents and the teachers too think that it wouldn't be a bad idea to flip these days to let these students who really need the most sleep and bring the ones who are already up at 4 in the morning, bring them into school. So anyway, this student just had a lovely letter sort of encouraging us to understand that, maybe do our homework and do some research to find out that, you know, indeed, even the American Academy of Pediatrics recently has come out and said, you know, we really should start talking about flipping when school starts for all the kids. So, I will just say his end is thank you for your time and consideration on this topic at hand. And I appreciate your thought of trying to do something to change the school start times. So, we did also have, and I apologize, I had it in my little bag and now it's gone. We had a lovely, lovely thank you card from Carpenter signed by all kinds of people for the lovely popcorn that was sent out to the buildings from the war before Christmas time. And a lot of cute little things on there and stuff, so we have those correspondence too. So that's it.
Can you pop a copy of that and page for a minute?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. I just have a question about communication. Didn't we get, I'm not sure if all board members got it, but the concern from a student, did it come to you, Sharon, about the concern about high school teachers in various classes giving homework to the point where particular students would not be able to complete it?
No, I did not get that. Is that recent?
It's probably been within the last 2-3 weeks.
I did not get that, I'm sorry.
Okay, well, I'll look for it and I'll forward that on. I did simply say to that student that that they should talk first with Mr. Other teacher and Mr. Chopsky and then go from there. But I had, just to kind of end on a funny note, I had a call. It was on our last snow or cold day. I got a call. I was cleaning up after dinner, and I got a call, and it was this little voice that said, are you going to have school tomorrow? Because it's really going to be bad out, and I just was wondering. I said, well, it's really way too early. There's people that actually drive the roads, and there's a big process involved in determining that. And so I said, you probably got my name and number from the website? And they said, yes. And I said, well, we actually have a superintendent, and he and some of the staff really look into that. And then they said, well, that's Eric. It sounds like that's a man. And I said, yes. And he said, the young lady said, well, they're so hard to persuade. And so then she said, I said,
And then, since we're having all the snow, why don't you go out and go sled riding? Nothing's better than sled riding at night. Come back in, have some hot chocolate, and then do some studying. She said, you know, I like that idea. And I said, and so I told her to let me. And then maybe hours later, we did call off school, and I thought, oh my gosh, I'm probably going to get a call.
Dude, did she celebrate? She was
well, she was at the high school.
Okay. She lives on Terry Street, I'm sure.
No, she isn't. No, and I asked her. Yeah, so it was just really great.
Sometimes we'll get contacted as a board, like we get this question from students. Sometimes it's like they know you or they know your kids went to that school, and they may just send it to one person, so it's not always unusual that, you know, the secretary would get something.
Oh, you mean, no, that homework thing was not.
Yeah, but what I'm just saying is that sometimes
I didn't know that person.
Okay. You get another phone call, and feel free to audio that.
Properly selected, carefully planned, and aimed at the educational development of the individual student. So hence,
why I like that he's not easily persuaded. That's too cool.
Okay. Board members request accounts payable check registry signatures.
I have something. I am actually on the registry for February 8th and 9th. Is anyone interested in training? I'll not be able to be there on February 8th.
I'll be here.
Do you want me to take your 25th and 6th?
I'll be here. I mean, yeah, it's fine. If you want to switch, sure.
Okay, awesome. Thank you.
Okay.
See how we problems.
Yeah. We're so good at it. Just, and if somebody gets caught for some reason, call me an optimist.
Before they get sick. Right?
Okay, is there anything else?
Oh, legislative update.
Another bill that they're working on is House Bill 4679,
And it would require that each physical agency prepare a note for all legislation before the committee hearing. So they're actually talking about figuring out what it might cost before they pass the law. Mm-hmm. So that's it. I think it's an interesting idea that our legislators start analyzing the impact of what they
forward thinking.
Extremely.
Should be common sense.
Yeah, where you might think it would be common sense.
That's not a criteria to be a policy. Excellent. Anything else?
Very briefly, the adequacy study that we mentioned and all of us have talked about or heard about did come out last week, in the middle of last week. And it is to say it's comprehensive would be an understatement, nearly 400 pages long. I read most of it, but I couldn't email it to the board because it's too large, so I'm going to upload it to Edge Portal, I can send you the link as well. It is very, very interesting. I'll just point to some quick conclusions on it, and basically they recommend this study, which was over a course of many months involving many different organizations, recommends that the base foundation allowance for Michigan students be around $9,500 per student, and that is base, meaning that other costs are not embedded into that. So they recommend a funding formula where that all students, including charter students, would receive $9,500 per student. However, students, district where we transport students would receive an enhancement on top of that based on real transportation costs. At-risk, special education students, and many other things would receive categoricals above the $9,500. In many cases, much more than that amount. So it was affirmed what we have had many conversations around in the past, followed up a more localized home county study from 2 years ago. I believe this is a very powerful and accurate assessment of cost of education, and I hope everyone can take a look at it and we can use that to be very positive and speak highly of public education in the upcoming months.
I looked at that thing too, and I'm the type like I want to pull it out and read it on paper, so I pull it up and I look and go 360 whatever pages, so I didn't. But I scanned it, and it was a very comprehensive study with a lot of people around the state, and there was a page that showed who was all involved in this. And I was very pleased to see that Mike DeVault from MISD, Joe DeVault from MISD, Paul Badia from MISD. Finance. We had three or four different people from our ISD involved in the study, and that's huge. I think we all know that Macomb County is a very involved ISD in the state and nationally. And quite honestly, that reputation precedes us. And for us to have had that great number of representation on this adequacy study, I was very pleased to find that out. So I was also pleased to find out that that number was, $1,200 higher than the prior adequacy study that the state had done, and that they did take out those big things that charters don't do. So, that's good.
And considering that some districts get a little over 7, all the way up to like 12 or 13, the disparity is great, so the fact that it's more accurate, I think if everyone I've talked to is more accurate, I think it's going to really help our local public schools.
Can I have a motion to adjourn?
So
moved.
Wait.
One more?
Calendar events.
Calendar
events. The dialogue day is February 23rd. All board members are invited. It's a important opportunity to interact with students, and it's extremely powerful.
I heard it was great.
I would suggest that all board members. It's held at Trinity Lutheran Church. And I think we've been doing this for about 15 years, and much of it is led by students. For those that want to listen, it's a tremendous opportunity.
Do you know the time?
It starts at, I'm looking at the time, it's usually 8:30 to 1:30, and they do breakout sessions. There's typically about 12 different breakout sessions, and you get the opportunity, and whether it's a family life or law within the school district, and I expect this year we'll see some things on vaping. But the students actually pick those topics, and adults and students sit together
then it's basically a sharing.
So it's a daytime.
You always learn, it's always a tremendous learning environment.
Kelly, is there any way you can send something out to the whole board?
Absolutely. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah,
if you have received your invites, I'll check and see if you can ask the question.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I've asked Kelly to send a list of the schools that we received these wonderful gifts.
Yes.
To all the board members who they wish to send a thank you card personally. And of course, I'm sure Sharon will be sending a group thank you card as well. Okay.
Now?
Now a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Or is it second?
Second?
Yes.
Since we learned we're not supposed to say so moved, take killers.